It's the forensic lunch. Whoa. That's weird. Why is it showing that when it should be on my host scene? Okay, now I'm there. It was a little confusing. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the show. If you've ever watched before, my name's Dave, and with me is Matt. Hey, Matt.
Howdy. Hey, if that's the only hiccup that happens today, we're doing really good.
Yeah, so it was really strange because I hit the button. I could see what should be the stream, and I'm looking at the preview window, and it's got something different. I'm like, that's not right. But, you know, I don't know if that was left over in the video buffer from before the last connection. I don't know. But let's talk about the fun stuff. This is Forensic Lunch, the once-a-week show where we talk everything about digital forensics, incident response, and new technology trends and research, and all the fun stuff that comes along with it. If you've never watched before, we do this weekly now during the COVID crisis. So every Friday at noon, live, we talk about interesting stuff, at least things that we think are interesting. And I got a special guest this week, special to me at least. Is Zach Wasserman from the OSQuery project and a couple other projects. We're going to talk all about OSQuery. We're going to get into Kollide, OSQuery, some of the other stuff that he's doing. I think you'll find that great. But of course, in every episode, we always check in with Matt. Matt, what are you doing?
Well, this week I've been working a little bit on my adding in the ETW functionality to my Rust monitors. So, kind of found out a couple interesting things that I didn't realize before. And one is that, so I've noticed something every time I use process monitor. I know we use process monitor a lot in this field just to kind of see what applications are doing and whatnot. But process monitor always creates an ETL file. Like, it's one of the first things it does. And, like, everyone's always kind of talked about listening to your event tracing in real time. And I've done that for a lot of my other stuff before, and it works. But I didn't realize, and even in like the MSDN documentation and whatnot, it shows, or it specifically says not to listen in real time, but rather write out to a file and then read from the file.
Hey, Matt.
So wait, that was kind of something new.
Wait 1 second, Matt, because the software's not switching scenes again. So, we're just, yeah, not a big deal.
Stuck with your crime scene.
Give it a second. There we go. Okay. Sorry about that, everybody. Every once in a while, things go wrong. And that's the fun of live broadcasting. But hopefully, that'll be the end of the problems. Matt, as you were saying.
Hopefully, that will be the end of the problem. What a great quote. So, so I've been working on some more on the ETL side, which is great because now that you've taken Pancake Viewer over, mm-hmm. I'm freed up with all the projects that I've always wanted to work on. So, yeah. Anyways, so I was going through the ETL documents on MSDN, and I realized that hey. You know, if I do this, I should probably be able to read from log files to you, since MSDN recommends, hey, if you're going to monitor, instead of monitoring and streaming in real time, just have it write to a file and then read from the file. Otherwise, you can miss buffers. Makes sense. I could definitely see that being a huge issue in Python. So the last ETL listening stuff that I did was in Python, and now I'm like, all right, I just kind of want to cut Python out of my life and switch over to Rust. And that works out for me as a personal goal, just because that's how you learn. It's just take the thing that you've always depended on, cut it out of your life, and then you can start depending on other things. So that's been my whole goal on all of this was that's why I started over. So originally what had happened was I started writing all of these like artifact monitors in Python. And then I was like, you know what? I just need to hit this thing head on and learn Rust and just switch it over to Rust. And that's how I'm going to learn Rust. And it'll all be a lot faster and more reliable than being in Python anyhow. So that's kind of why this Rust, I have that followed suit with the PY Win Thingies name. So now it's RS Win Thingies. Anyway, so that's yeah, what I've been working on is trying to get some of the ETL stuff working. I had it working in Python, at least enough for a proof of concept. And so now I'm kind of moving all that over to Rust. And the whole reason behind on why I'm doing this is not to create like an EDR tool or anything like that. It's because this is my favorite way to trigger events for artifact monitoring. Because remember, your artifacts are binary structures that are contained in some other file. Like it could be like binary structures within a certain registry key, right? So every time this registry key gets updated, you're going to have to parse that registry key out, put that binary data into structures, and you know, massage it, right? So using ETL is just a great way to know when you should parse out an artifact, display you the results of it, do differentials, so that you can see in real time how forensic artifacts change as you interact with the system, right? Anyways, so yeah, just working towards achieving that goal.
So Kev asks, for the Pancake Viewer repo, should he do continued pull requests against yours or against the fork that I'm hosting?
I would say continue to do it against mine. I don't know. I need to switch that over to you at some point. I've never done that before. I think it's easy, though. You just go into the repository and switch owners. We probably need to have another Pancake Nerd Out night on the test kitchen.
Yes, we do.
And then what else? Yeah. Thanks, Kevin. By the way, Kevin runs on Duncan has contributed quite a bit this last week to Pancake Viewer, getting it much more pretty in Linux. So I think that's awesome. It's cool that it's running in Linux. Again, that was always kind of one of those little unique points of, hey, theoretically, this should work in Linux, and then did anything with it. And here comes Kev runs on Duncan, and the whole thing magically works, and so that's cool. But, yeah.
Nice. So
you know what? To play into our next segment, I want to talk about one other thing.
Okay.
Which is query language.
Okay.
So one of the biggest issues with all of this stuff that I do is output, right? Like, so I just kind of in my day-to-day, I work with a lot of JSON. I throw it into backends, and then that's where I work from. So I don't care to make things pretty for people because I kind of just code for me anyhow. So even with my open source stuff, I'm like, you can do something with the JSON, whatever. But so one of the issues has been, though, when you monitor an artifact in real time, you get this JSON data and it's nasty. And I've made some transformation tools to help out with that. So like while you're streaming JSON lines out, I have transformation tools that you can use like JMES path query to kind of select the attributes that you want to transform. And then using JMES path query, which is one of my favorite JSON query tools, you know, it gives you a little bit more functionality and flexibility on how you want to transform that data. So then you can just create text out of that, right? So I have this tool that basically you write some JMES path queries, then it just formats it into a delimited text output. And that's kind of what I use on top of my monitor so that I can actually just see the fields I want to see. And they're somewhat pretty enough for me to figure out what's happening as I do stuff in real time. Anyways, but I've always loved the idea. I love query languages. And this is why this fits into our next segment, is because a lot of this work that we do is all about data transformation and how you display your results and what results you want to see, right? And in the back of my head, I've always wanted to try and create a query language just to deal with, you know, data transformation as it comes out of one thing, like JSON or whatever, but make it pretty, something like SQL, right? Because that doesn't really exist for JSON. One of my favorites is, you've all seen me, I like to talk about ArongoDB a lot. ArongoDB has a great query language, AQL, and it looks just like SQL. I love Arongo because it allows you to use nested documents and do relational queries on nested documents, which is a big deal for us. But I've always wanted to take something like that and just do it on like just JSON files or whatever. So I can query, because I want to do the same thing where I query these artifacts and it's just a query language on top of artifact parsers. Mm-hmm. That would be awesome to me. Anyhow, I digress. Let's talk about some OS query stuff.
Yeah, no, I think that's what we're about to get. For those who've been reading the daily blog, you know that I've been experimenting with the AWS EBS block API. That's going to continue to move forward. I think there's a lot of cool stuff we can do there. I'm excited about it. I hope for those of you who've been following along, you are as well. But that, the ideal of forensic scale, the ability to work interactively between operating systems, to be able to gather large amounts of data and queries in a substantive fashion, is what brings our guest today. So please welcome to the show, Zach Wasserman. Thank you for joining us.
Hello, everyone.
So, Zach, when I decided that it was time to get someone to come and talk about OSQuery, I didn't just want to pull someone that I knew OSQuery well. I actually went into the OSQuery Slack, asked officially, you know, who could kind of speak for the project, and you were kind of the designated official OSQuery spokesman. And so the reason I bring that up is I wanted to make people understand that Zach's not here just to give his opinion. Zach's here to talk about, you know, as a member of the steering committee for the project, of kind of where things are, where they're going. So this is as bona fide as OSQuery talk is going to get.
So I'll just say there is no designated spokesperson for the steering committee, but I do sit on that steering committee. Working on the present and future of OSQuery, and I'm happy to be here to share any insights that I can about the project and talk about OSQuery and Fleet and how it can be useful to folks who are listening in now.
Yeah, so let's start with, you know, I think most people are familiar with the fact that it exists, right? OSQuery is a thing. It's been a thing for quite a while, and you were there for kind of the genesis of that thing. But rather than rehash the past and all the rest, I think our audience is technical. They understand the points of where do you think OSQuery is today, and where do you and the steering committee see it going in the future?
Yeah, I mean, today OSQuery is certainly the premier open agent for extracting security relevant data from systems. So we've got first-class support for Mac and Linux, and we've been really shoring up the Windows support over the last couple of years since that was added. And I think that we're going to see more and more OSQuery become like this standard agent that a number of products build their entire experience on top of, because OSQuery is able to expose just a wealth of data that it's useful to security practitioners and also to IT folks and operations folks and anyone who wants to understand what the state is of systems and how that's changing.
And I think that to me was one of the biggest surprises when I went to a large organization that had OSQuery, is that depending upon the group, they also OSQuery as their tool for X. You know, no one really like looked at the bigger picture of it's doing all of these things, right? So like the engineering people see it as a performance, health, and monitoring tool, while the security team sees it as a monitoring metric tool, and the IR team sees it as an ability, depending upon their use of Carver or custom extensions, as a response tool. So it's been really interesting to see how everyone kind of sees their part of it.
Yeah, it's a great point, and it's something that was really in mind at the genesis of the project, that as a security team, you know, we really valued being able to get the data off the host that we were looking for, but we wanted to be deploying to, you know, Facebook's production infrastructure. And you can't really do that without getting some buy-in from folks beyond security. Mm-hmm. So you have to focus on making sure that the data is really relevant. You're sort of hitting the needs of not only a security organization so that other folks can take advantage of it, and then that you're being really efficient with the resource usage. And I think that all of those things together have sort of lended to the success of OSQuery becoming like this agent that gets deployed very widely, and you know, now certainly to millions and millions of endpoints across dozens or hundreds of organizations.
So Gerald asks, is there a link you can provide to get us diving into OSQuery? I mean, OSQuery.io, right?
Yeah, I mean, check out OSQuery.io. There's a couple of small examples of queries that you could write there, but maybe we spend 30 seconds talking about what OSQuery is.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so you know, hearing Matt talking about query languages, I think this was the big insight of OSQuery. So Mike Arpaia had previously built agents for pulling data off of devices and doing analysis on that data. But one of the primary goals of OSQuery was, how can we create a query language that allows us to define our data sources once, you know, by writing code, typically C++ in the case of OSQuery, but then let analysts, people who aren't software engineers and people who just want to get work done, how can they extract that data, transform it, filter it, and do useful things with it? So the insight with OSQuery was, let's build it on top of a real SQL engine. So in this case, it's SQLite. So you have the full power of the SQLite query language. And then we hook into all of the system APIs, the file system, you know, the processes that are running, any sort of possible place that there could be data that is interesting to us. We export those as though they were tables in SQLite. And then we get that querying power on top of all of that.
Very cool. Let's then talk about, you know, that's the current state of OSQuery. You know, what is the steering committee? You know, what's the next big goals for the year? Like, where are you hoping to take the current project?
Yeah, I mean, I think the biggest goals for this year of OSQuery are, as some folks may know, last June, the project transitioned from being run by Facebook to a project of the Linux Foundation. So we're still kind of working on how can we appropriately fund the project so that we can just have some core development and stability work going on. And what does that organization look like? I think we need to, we're still working on defining a roadmap for the next few years. And I think from a technical perspective, to me, the things that are most exciting that are coming up are particularly on Linux, how do we look into container support and how will we guide people in terms of how to use OSQuery in an environment where everything's ephemeral, everything's running in containers, and we still want to get insight into what's going on.
So Gerald says, I'm very interested in its functionality, capability, and seeing how well it works with a sim. I know what I'll be doing this afternoon. I think you'll be very happy, Gerald. So let's talk for a second then about what you just said about containers, because there is, you know, a kind of a community support for containers, right? People have figured, there's a Docker container support now. You can run a container in privileged mode, and OSQuery can introspect into the other containers and pull stuff out. There is container support today. What do you, you know, and that's what kind of triggered me when you said that, and I mean triggered in a good way, is where do you see that extending? Because right now, you know, the Docker integration is pretty great as far as, you know, what allows you to pull back. You know, where do you think you can go next?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the challenges of OSQuery is that we've got a ton of capabilities there. I mean, if you go and look at osquery.io/schema and see what tables are available, there's hundreds of data sources. So I think one of the things to do is we need to, as a community, start talking more about what it looks like to do proper analytics and logging on this kind of ephemeral infrastructure. and in these containerized systems. But we're also bringing new and interesting capabilities in terms of containers regularly. So the 4.3.0 release of OSQuery that came out yesterday contains a new table that can show you all of the changes to a Docker containers file system.
Nice.
Since that container started. So that's cool.
That's very
cool. and Stefano Bonicati from Trail of Bits is working on some really cool stuff that will let us look from the host into what's going on into the containers by sort of switching the namespace that we're doing the introspection on. Mm-hmm. So I think that what we're going to see is some advancement of the capabilities in terms of things like that. And then as a community, we need to come together and define what best practices are for monitoring within containers. And then we'll just kind of keep shoring up the support within OSQuery to make sure that that's that OSQuery is a great tool to do that.
Mm-hmm. And so this leads to Vico's question, which I think is a good follow-up question. So when can we run OSQuery against a disk image? Now, Zach, my understanding is that OSQuery is kind of one core, central point of data ingestion, but also its core limitation that people need to understand is that it's really tied to APIs and what the OS exposes or what the other processes expose to it. It's not like it's some kind of EDR tool that's going to be hijacking kernel commands and like doing introspection and disk scanning.
Yeah, and in fact, there's no there are no kernel modules or kernel extensions in OSQuery, which was in part an intentional design decision just to ensure that there was really good stability. Mm-hmm. And we found that so much of what we were interested in, we were able to get without doing that sort of thing anyway.
Yeah.
But I as far as the way that OSQuery retrieves the data, there are plenty of things where we do go and read the file system and extract data out of files or extract metadata out of the file system.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
So we could do that across all the three platforms, Mac, Linux, and Windows. Now, the way the code is architected, it certainly expects that it has access to a normal sort of running operating system. So I would say that there's no plans currently on the roadmap for running against like a non-live machine. And if this is something that folks are interested in, hop into the OSQuery Slack and let's talk about it, because I think that we are going to see more work on like running OSQuery on ARM and then starting to look towards mobile devices and that kind of thing. And I think that that as much as possible, we'd like the abstractions created by OSQuery to apply to any sort of scenario that's relevant to our security target audience.
Yeah, and I think to the point, OSQuery is open source and extensible, and there is a variety of languages that are supported to write custom extensions if someone wanted to extend it a particular way. What would you say right now is kind of like the go-to language of choice when it comes to running extensions? Seems to be most stable when called out.
Yeah, for me, it's Go. Mm-hmm. Because the OSQuery extension model allows us to distribute a separate binary that the OSQuery process will start and manage, and that binary can expose additional capabilities. So, the best support really is in C++, Python, and Go. And in terms of just getting things done, being able to deploy something that works, for me, it's reaching to Go. We just have a super easy build system. We can cross-compile for whatever system that we want, and the library support is great there. So, if you go check out github.com/collide/OSQuery-go, then I bet you can have an OSQuery extension up and running in less than an hour, and then you can put whatever data you want into OSQuery, mm-hmm. and that data lives in a first-class kind of format in OSQuery. You can join it against any of the built-in data tables. Mm-hmm. It really has the full functionality of OSQuery when you put the data in through an extension.
That's awesome. And I think kind of the model of tying the majority of the data sources, I agree that, you know, the hash table goes against a disk, the file table goes against a disk, there's other ones, but tying into what the OS provides in order to collect the majority of statistics, I think has not only led to a more stable product, but has made it so that you're one of the few things that has survived the, I would call them the purges that have occurred in the Mac OS world as they've locked down their security paradigm.
Yeah, I mean, with Mac, it's an ever-evolving situation, and we've certainly relied on APIs in the past that are no longer available or that require granting, you know, having an MDM and granting specific entitlements and this sort of thing these days. But yeah, a lot of what we're doing is just user space operations, and we can get a lot of good data that way. And, you know, one more thing that I'll add on the point of looking at something like a static image is that one of the other great things about OSQuery is that we run this diffing engine that lets us schedule queries so that we can get the current state of something, log that, and then only log any changes that happen when the query is run. So, you know, you lose out on that kind of capability if you're running against just like a forensic dump of something. So I think that's a, you know, that's a thing worth noting. And really, you're in the best shape if you've deployed OSQuery in advance of your incident. You're retrieving, you're pulling logs in that are showing you what normal looks like on mm-hmm. that system, and then you have the differential logs that show the changes that represent bad things happening.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I, you know, everyone today talks about threat hunting and compromise assessments and continuous monitoring. I mean, that's where the data is, and I agree with you. If you can compare normal to time of event, it makes things so much easier. So we've talked about kind of the core agent side, but there's a whole another side of things, right? And that's the fleet management and the querying, and I think this would be a great time to kind of transition over to talking about Kollide.
Yeah, so from the management perspective, OSQuery, you know, has a quite a bit of configuration surface. We've got these scheduled queries that we tell it to run, and it outputs the differential results. And you know, as we know, the landscape is evolving really quickly, and we always have different information that we're interested in. Sometimes we want to be logging that information. Sometimes we want to be doing hunting, that sort of thing, or doing response. And so OSQuery has APIs built in for remote management that that make it like pretty awesome for those threat hunting and response kind of use cases. So I was a co-founder at Kollide, which these days offers like a fully managed cloud OSQuery product. But we also created Kollide Fleet, which is an open source fleet manager for OSQuery. And so that takes advantage of all of those APIs mm-hmm. to let us manage OSQuery, understand the status of OSQuery in real time. And that's become really popular and sort of the de facto fleet manager for OSQuery. So if you want that kind of remote capability in OSQuery, you know, check out Fleet. It's awesome.
Yeah. And so I think that's probably for those who are used to kind of the standard commercial endpoint agent solutions that they're missing, is that they think that these two things should naturally come together, right? That there is a management platform somewhere with a web interface where you can inventory, check, and issue tasking, and then there's these agents that are deployed. But with OSQuery, it's really two separate things. You can have the agents completely standalone, collecting statistics, forwarding logs back to whatever your central source is, or if you choose to, you could have some type of TLS endpoint that then can become the fleet manager for all of these endpoints, allowing you to centrally manage and control them. Now, let's talk about Fleet specifically, or Kollide Fleet, and kind of, and I think you said you had an instance up where you can show it to show people kind of how this works, what it looks like, and then some of the more interesting queries that, you know, you can really start showing kind of the power of OSQuery with.
Yeah, totally. So let me share my screen here, and hopefully folks, let's see. David, do you think that folks are able to see this now?
Yes, I just have to do this because it comes as a separate feed.
There we go. Cool. So now we're looking at the Kollide Fleet dashboard. So, you know, this is just a test instance I've got up running here. You can see I've got like a couple of Linux hosts. These are actually running in Docker, so what we'll find is, unfortunately, there's not too much interesting information to look at these. But in this dashboard, we see that we have hosts that are actively checking in. We get some basic information about them, such as what their uptime is, the basic stats, some network information. And I think really, if we're just going to jump right into it, the killer feature is, if we want to see some information about these hosts, mm-hmm. we can come in here and run a live query against the host. So we just hit run. Right now they're configured to check in every 10 seconds. So we should usually see the results within about 10 seconds. And here they are. So this is not a particularly interesting one. Select star from OSQuery info. This just gives us some information about the OSQuery installation. Mm-hmm. But we can see that we get that stuff. It starts to get more interesting if we want to know, for example, what are the active processes running on this host. And again, like I said, this is a Docker container running OSQuery. So what we're going to see here is there's not much running. It's pretty much just the two OSQuery processes. But we can filter this down. We can use this for our threat hunting. We can do things like output all of the processes on a host that's running, or output all the processes that are listening on network sockets or that have active network connections. We can do things like get the Wi-Fi networks that it's connected to, or if it's a Windows machine, start looking at the services. Like, these are all things that can be really useful to start to get our bearings in an incident response kind of situation. And as far as interesting queries go, let's see if we can find it here. But yeah,
that process tree one is cool.
Yeah. So, you know, a lot of what you see folks doing with OSQuery is this sort of thing: select star from processes, or select star from processes where on disk equals zero, which would give us processes that are running where the binaries are no longer there. So, which is often, a pretty interesting artifact. Or get the hash of this file, like some basic kind of stuff. But we can do sophisticated stuff as well, like this one, which is going to get the whole process tree of a process of an OSQuery process that's running on this host. So we can see here, again, this is not too interesting because it's just a couple of OSQuery processes, but we can see that we've got PID 8 with parent 1, PID 1 with parent 0, and then, and there is no PID 0. So I think we're just in a kind of a weird situation here. This sort of thing is much more interesting if I'm going like, okay, well, now I only want the process trees of a process where the binary matches this hash. And so I can just come and change this query in here and start to get that sort of information. So that's really cool. The other thing that we can do, which is quite nice in Fleet, is we can go, this is we've decided this is a useful query. So now let's save this. We'll save the query, and then we can come and create query pack, and we'll say we want to target that to all the hosts, and we can add that query to the pack and say every 30 seconds I want you to run that query and give me differentials. And so now that query will be scheduled, and now these hosts are continuously checking in, asking for their configuration that they should run. Mm-hmm. So now the host will come in, pull this query, and start outputting results back to Fleet. And it doesn't have to be Fleet. There's actually a number of ways that we can do the logging from OSQuery. Built into OSQuery, there's some logging to AWS services, file system, syslog, Kafka, that kind of stuff, or to the remote server. So in this case, I think these hosts are probably configured to log to the remote server, which means that the logs will show up on the file system of our Fleet server. And now, once the logs are there, we can do whatever we want to push them into a logging pipeline to get them into our CM or whatever it is that we'd like to do. Mm-hmm. So hopefully that helps to illuminate a little bit what the capabilities are of such a tool like this. Another thing that I'll point out is we can create labels that would dynamically categorize our hosts. So for example, we could create a label that targets just these couple of hosts here, you know, with the IP, or maybe only hosts that are running, you know, again, not that interesting because this is all we've got here, but you know, select one from processes where name equals OSQuery D. You know, this is going to give us hosts that are running OSQuery. Of course, this is going to be all the hosts. After a few minutes, that will be populated. A more interesting one might be, you know, select one from processes where name equals MySQL D, and now we're going to get all the hosts. We're going to get all the hosts that are running MySQL, mm-hmm. and we can use that to target further queries. So now here's my list of OSQuery hosts. I can come to the live query page and I can say, okay, I just want to target only the OSQuery hosts, which again, not that interesting in this case, with the query that that I want to run. And this can sort of help you start to look for things that are anomalous. You know, we can look at all of our MySQL hosts and say, well, this MySQL host is the only one that's running this process that's creating a network connection to an IP that's outside of our network, you know, and that's not running on anything else. So this is how OSQuery starts to let us do interesting threat hunting kind of stuff, and then pivot all of that into monitoring and into pushing the logs into our CM or whatever we like to do to create alerts and to create logs.
Yeah, and I think this is something that for those who have worked in kind of these large scale environments, which has already been architected, is kind of second nature. But one of the things you talked about that I think a lot of people may not be as familiar with is the idea of the fact that you can basically split your data feeds, right? So your pre-scheduled queries that are coming out of the agents that are, you know, whatever, however the packs come together based upon the properties of the agent, can be funneled back through whatever your logging pipeline is into, you know, whatever data lake or storage facility, while at the same time, you know, OSQuery the Fleet Manager, and in this case, let's say Kollide Fleet, is able to query and task the agent separately, but also can be configured to be able to come back in and kind of search that data. It's not like the traditional kind of monolithic approach where your whatever is managing those endpoint agents, it also has to be the thing that receives the logs for it to work. Like, you can actually decouple an infrastructure, allowing you to kind of grow out and scale out, you know, the massive amounts of data that could be coming out of this.
Totally. Yeah, I mean, that's absolutely the case. And it really allows you to evolve your deployment. You can start with, like, maybe all you want to do is deploy the OSQuery agent and get that live query capability. Or maybe you don't even want to have the central management at all. You can start by just logging to the file system and running something like FluentD or Logstash or whatever to push the logs into an aggregation system that you already have. So it really allows you to fit everything together. And you know, on the other hand, this means that you have to know what you have to have established logging pipeline for these logs to go into. Mm-hmm. You have to be able to make sense of the data. You have to know what queries you want to run. Mm-hmm. So this is also, I think, where there is the space for these commercial vendors like Kollide and like Uptix, who are providing these like fully integrated cloud solutions so that you can just kind of get the insights without having to put in all the work to set up the systems. But I think for those who are, you know, really want to dig into it and customize everything, using something like Fleet with OSQuery, like, it's just a bounty of possibilities.
Yeah. And I think that's probably the biggest limiter, right? So if you have kind of a DevOps-based organization where the entire, you know, response to second to the backend engineering are all kind of tasked with the idea that they're building and eating their own dog food, and they're building tools because nothing can support whatever crazy idea they came up with 5 years ago that they're stuck with. This can kind of be that solution that lets them build that thing that's custom for them, while the other organizations that, you know, really have a core competency in what they do but are not driven by this DevOps mentality are allowed to kind of fall back on these commercial vendors who are able to kind of support them and give them that experience. What are you seeing right now as far as, you know, what you see people implementing it with?
Yeah, I mean, and I guess one more thing interesting to point out is even the big dogs like Carbon Black are jumping in on the OSQuery thing, and you can get some OSQuery capabilities through, I think it's like their response product or something.
Did not know that.
So they deploy an OSQuery agent and let you take advantage of some of that stuff. But, you know, in my current work, I do consulting working with organizations who want to deploy OSQuery like as a part of their internal security processes, mm-hmm. and also who want to build products that rely on OSQuery. So what I'm typically seeing is a lot of folks using things like Fleet to build the whole custom experience because they want the control over everything. Mm-hmm. That's mostly what I'm working with. And then I think I also see situations in which, you know, a fleet manager isn't even necessarily what would be the most useful. Like, we just want to be able to drop down a package with OSQuery and some basic configurations and have it logged to AWS so that they can just tell their customers, like, hey, deploy this MSI and we're going to get the logs that we need to give you the insights that we want.
Mm-hmm. We have a good question coming in. Is there a way to throttle the agent to prevent it from potentially impacting system performance?
Yeah, so absolutely. So there's something that we call the watchdog that's constantly watching the agent. So it actually runs as two processes. One's the watcher and one's the worker. The watcher watches the worker, and if the worker is ever using beyond the thresholds that you set, it's automatically killed and restarted by the watcher process. Mm-hmm. And typically this sort of thing happens when you write a query that causes OSQuery to say, try to hash every file on the file system. Because you can write such queries, and it can be not even that difficult to do that kind of thing. So you have this safety valve there, and then when a query is shut down because of using too many resources, it's then blacklisted and not attempted to be run again for 24 hours. And then you can collect into your logging pipeline which queries have been blacklisted, and then work on making sure that those queries are optimized or removed, they're running less often or that kind of thing. And if you're interested in the performance implications of OSQuery and how to do those sort of things, I have a talk on my website, dactiv.llc, that's called, I believe, Monitoring. It's called OSQuery Performance at Scale, and it talks about all of these things that exist within OSQuery to help you manage the performance. Yeah. But really, performance is at the heart of the design of OSQuery, and it is typically extremely performant. You know, such that OSQuery is deployed on the entirety of Facebook mm-hmm. production infrastructure. Yep. Like, we're talking about people who 1% of CPU means like tens of millions of dollars a year.
Yeah, and I think that's probably the most interesting thing about the OSQuery project when it comes to kind of an open source framework as compared to other projects in the same space, is that because this was kind of invented and sponsored by Facebook initially, you know, while other projects were invented as an interesting idea, and then they're like, oh yeah, we have it on 1,000 hosts, or yeah, we've created a test instance with 10,000 hosts. I know multiple huge organizations, in addition to Facebook, that this is their day-to-day endpoint metric security detection and response tool. It's across hundreds of thousands of endpoints.
Yeah, I mean, it's no doubt OSQuery is deployed across millions of endpoints, and it really works. And it's not without its problems, but it really works, and it provides features that allow you to confidently operate it at this kind of scale. You know, just to throw another sort of feature out there, there's something that we call sharding within these query packs. So we can say, roll out a query to only 1% of hosts that receive the configuration by setting the shard key. So, you know, if we come up with a new query that we want to deploy into production, we'll start by sharding it at 1, so 1% of the hosts get it, and then maybe 10% of the hosts get it, and then 50, and all the while we're looking at our metrics and making sure that OSQuery isn't all of a sudden taking down these machines. So it's really well thought out for these kind of large-scale use cases, but it also totally works on a small scale. Like, you know, I know plenty of folks who are running Fleet on 50 machines and just getting some nice capabilities there.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the use cases are only limited what you can think of. And I think one of the most interesting things for me as I kind of dug into OSQuery initially and we started kind of building out these query packs is if you can find the right join, you know, you can basically create a new aggregated data source that just wasn't provided by the tool natively, but because you found that query, you can suddenly bring out new data insights. And if for everything else, you know, you decide to support or bring in, you know, you can kind of expand your range of visibility.
Right, absolutely. And that's, again, where we come to the beauty of SQL. And you saw we dropped in that, like, that process tree query earlier. Mm-hmm. You know, you could do some really complex stuff. And you know, level one is just start to get the basic information. Drop me a list of the users, mm-hmm. drop me a list of the processes, this kind of stuff. And that's useful. Like, for a lot of folks, that is just like insight that they did not have previously. Yeah. But we can also do much more interesting things, like pulling in Yara signatures and then getting the network connections for processes that are matching certain Yara signatures, and we can do things like file integrity monitoring, mm-hmm. and we can, you know, we can filter on really, really deep and interesting stuff just by writing the SQL queries. And then we can share those. And if you look, there's a number of good resources for finding like interesting queries to run, such as, the ones published by Palantir, that I think if you search Palantir OSQuery, it'll be easy to find those. So that's some cool stuff made by Chris Long, who was, you know, worked with OSQuery early on at Facebook. And the Recon InfoSec folks have published mm-hmm. some interesting queries. And, you know, if you want to do sophisticated things, hop into the OSQuery Slack and, like, join the Pound SQL channel, and we can figure out how to do some really awesome stuff. I'd also say, like, Fritz from Kollide has written some really interesting queries. And if you look on the Kollide blog, they've blogged about that kind of stuff. So really, it's not just that there's 200 and some data sources or 300 data sources or whatever. It's that every one of those can be combined with other ones to generate insights mm-hmm. that in the past maybe you'd have to write code to do. Now you just write a SQL query.
Yeah, I love that. That to me is my favorite thing. And like one good example is you had earlier on a show executables that are not on disk or running processes not on disk. That's cool. A while back, Cowan and I did a talk at a FireEye, one of the FireEye ones, and we were like, okay, here's some different queries that you can do where you take multiple artifacts and kind of correlate the data between them to ask questions and get the answers to assign like kind of threat levels, right? And that was one was, hey, let's look at the prefetch data and shim cache data, and let's look for things that have ran but are no longer on disk. And we could, we would create like SQLite queries from these parsed artifacts that would say, okay, here's an executable that ran from the prefetch, query this against the MFT, and look to see if that executable is still on disk or go through its imported DLLs, right? So the ability to be able to take the data from multiple points and do correlations is huge. And it's something that we've talked often about. But yeah, that to me is the best part.
Zach, just Fritz says that he learned it all from you and that he went to the Zach SQL School. And Melissa says, can we do this more often? Melissa, we do it every week. The Forensic Lunch is every Friday now, so feel free to turn in next Friday, where I believe if I look at the schedule, next Friday is the Google IR team coming to talk about an update and all of kind of the Google-sponsored and supported IR projects like Dravenia, TimeSketch, Plazo. So make sure to come back next week if this is the kind of stuff that you like to hear. Or you can watch the recording if, you're doing something at home other than, because you're not going anywhere.
Yeah. that sounds great. And Melissa, if you want to talk more about OSQuery, just Google OSQuery Slack and you can join us where there's quite a nice active community of folks using OSQuery in a number of use cases and who are eager to chat and help.
And Zach, I'm leaving your video on as I say this because right below you there happens to be another way to get in contact with you.
Yeah, so I also do consulting with OSQuery and with Fleet. Like I said, I mean, I do internal deployments. I help people develop products. I do all sorts of things. So if you think that this could bring value to your organization, but you don't have the bandwidth to do it, please get in touch. Zach@dactiv.llc, or you can reach me on Twitter and OSQuery Slack or any of those places, and we'll see if we can find a way to, help bring all of this awesome OSQuery stuff into your org.
Now, we've talked a lot about, kind of all the cool stuff you can do. But, usually, every time we have a technical conversation, we also need to talk, address tech debt. We need to address, the limitations, the things that are aware that people should be aware of before they come into this with eyes closed, accepting this as their newfound savior. what are the key considerations that people should make sure they're aware of before they go headlong into the idea that OSQuery will fix all their problems?
Oh yeah, I think the first is OSQuery is just a huge set of capabilities, and you need to know what you're looking for. If you know what you're looking for, you can probably find it with OSQuery. If you don't know what you're looking for, then OSQuery does not solve that problem for you. Yeah. I think that's one. Another one is you might get really excited and see that you can log this and that and everything and start generating a lot of logs that are not useful to you. And then you're paying for your Splunk instances or your Elasticsearch instances or whatever that you're using to do the aggregation and the searching for data that's not relevant. And I think that's a real risk. And even though we have these differential query capabilities that do try to keep the volume down, some stuff is just really noisy. And then, as was mentioned, it's entirely possible to write queries that have unacceptable performance. And we do have these mechanisms in OSQuery that prevent you from taking down the system by doing that, but you won't get the visibility that you were expecting to get, or you might be tempted to raise those limits and then be taking on real performance issues with the systems that you're managing.
Yep.
So I think, to me, those are the top concerns to look out for. And I think that one thing that we've also said is, some folks look at OSQuery like, oh, it's going to fix everything for me. But how do I get it installed on my endpoints?
Yep.
Like, if you can't figure out how to get OSQuery installed on your endpoints because you don't have that level of configuration management or that kind of thing, like, you're just not ready for OSQuery yet.
Yes.
But maybe that's a good time to look at something like the Kollide Cloud, where they'll just give you a double click thing and they'll start giving you notifications of things that may be real security and management concerns for you when you had no visibility at all.
Yeah, no, absolutely right. And I'm seeing, the majority of the environments where I see OSQuery really widely deployed are the heavy Linux and Mac environments with some Windows. And the majority of them seem to be pushing out with Chef. Have you found, any other kind of popular tie-in there that you've seen your clients using?
Yeah, I mean, Chef and Puppet are super common for that kind of thing. And one of the cool things is that you drop the OSQuery agent, and if you hook it up to a TLS server like Fleet, then you don't really have to touch it very often, except for every couple of months when the binary is updated. So mostly you just get the minimum config that lets you start talking to the server, and then the server pushes down all of the configurations that you need for your day-to-day operations. So to me, that's great, and hopefully you don't need to actually do too much configuration outside of those sorts of things.
Yep. And so Recon is watching, and so they put a link that YouTube wouldn't let them use, but Matt has relinked it, and I'll make sure that I put that in the show notes as well. As Zach was saying, it's kind of a disjointed set of collections of queries out there. There are some, there's lots of queries that are baked in, don't get me wrong, into the product, and there's other queries that are out there. I think, as we're technically running out of time, there is no time limit, really. I would like to ask you, personally, from a selfish interest, is who's maintaining the Carver, and what are the ideas for kind of lifting some of the restrictions around the total size of files that can come back?
That's a great question, David. I don't know who's maintaining the Carver, and right now I'll say Fleet, which is my main focus, doesn't support it.
Mm-hmm.
And let's just say that that'll be coming very soon in Fleet.
Mm-hmm.
And then that will kind of give me some motivation to look into that and see from the OSQuery side what the limitations are and how we can fix those.
Cool.
And as with everything, like, this is an open source, these are open source projects. So if folks have things that they want to do, one, just do them. Like, we'll review the PRs and we'll get them merged. And, if it's something that is on the more complex side, put up a blueprint first so that we can talk about it and make sure it's something the project wants. And two, if you can't do it yourself, but you want it, you can hire me to do it, and we'll contribute it upstream, and everyone will get to benefit from that. And that's how we have things like the AWS logging plugins in OSQuery. Mm-hmm. Like, that exists because Airbnb hired me to do that years ago.
Thanks.
And those are, really widely used now. So if things are not working the way we want, like, let's fix them. This is up to everyone here. It's no black box. It's just there waiting.
So we've talked about, some of your work. We talk about the future of OSQuery. But one of the things that we didn't directly talk about, and you're one of the main, developers and contributors to Fleet, is kind of where Fleet's going next. What are your direct plans for the open source part of Fleet?
Yeah, so Fleet, we've always seen as, you know, it doesn't try to be a full product. In the same way that OSQuery doesn't try to be a full product, mm-hmm. Fleet doesn't try to be a full product. It just tries to open up capabilities to you in ways that you can integrate very effectively with your own systems. So I think that we're just going to see continued work along those lines. One of the big things that's coming up is some massive performance improvements to Fleet that are going to let folks start deploying it as a manager for up to like hundreds of thousands of hosts, nice. In which it's just not, you know, at that level right now. And thankfully, folks are using Fleet and starting to get to that level. So we're addressing those issues. The other thing is file carving. We're going to bring that in there so that we're taking full advantage of the capabilities of OSQuery on that front. And then beyond those things, I think it's whatever the community is looking for and folks are contributing to. But I think that there's nothing revolutionary coming down the pipe in terms of Fleet, but it's gonna be more awesome, and it's gonna be really cool to see folks running Fleet on 100,000, 200,000 mm-hmm. endpoints and really doing open source, fully open source security at like a big scale.
Nice. And what's interesting to me is because the agent and the manager are kind of decoupled, you have other open source projects now coming along to try to, you know, try their own version experimentation of a Fleet manager. So like I know Javi from OS Control. So that's another one. I mean, are you seeing more of this now where people are getting, you know, interested enough to try their hand to see, you know, what they can do?
Yeah, a little bit of that. And Fleet has never been the only game in town, really, as far as Fleet managers go. There's been Zentral for quite a long time. And there was Sargent from Okta there. I'm not sure if that one's being maintained anymore. Yeah, and Javier's working on OS Control. And I think that, you know, it's just a question of what sort of infrastructure do folks want to be managing? Do you mm-hmm. want something that's very highly integrated or something that's just kind of light and lets you set up things however you want? That's sort of the stance that Fleet has always taken. And then, you know, this isn't a Fleet manager thing, but another really interesting thing that we just saw come out recently was the Zeek agent. So Zeek is, oh, yeah. is formerly Bro. Mm-hmm. They've created a new agent that works with OSQuery to provide some really interesting connections between what's going on with the host and what's going on in the network. And that Zeek is already really effective at doing.
Interesting. I was not aware of that. That's awesome.
Yeah, so check that out.
Nice. Well, yeah, Zach, I think we covered the things that we were planning to talk about. Is there anything else that we didn't particularly talk about or that you wanted to get out there?
I think we've covered a lot of good stuff, and I'll just say, you know, thanks everyone for tuning in. And if you want to chat more about these things, I'm ZWAS on OSQuery Slack, or shoot me a tweet, shoot me an email or whatever. And I'm just excited that open source is the future.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, it really is. I mean, when you consider, you know, that these projects can be maintained. I mean, I think one of the big things that you said that I wasn't aware of is the fact that, you know, OSQuery has moved under the Linux Foundation. So now it's going to be, you know, it should allow it to grow even, you know, kind of larger outside the constraints of its original, you know, adoptive parents and into a larger, more stable project in the future. So I think that's really cool. Sorry, you look like you're going to say something. Good.
Yeah, no, it's great. I think that, you know, moving to an independent organization is not without its pains. That's for sure, but I think the future is really bright, and you know, figuring out how we can get the organization some funding so that people can do, you know, the basic integrity of OSQuery work, like having really solid testing and release mm-hmm. processes and that kind of stuff. And working on finding hopefully like some corporate sponsors for doing that kind of thing. So if anyone out there is listening and your organization might be able to be that sort of thing, like let's please be in touch. I think the future of the project is really bright.
Absolutely. Well, thanks, Zach. Thanks to all of you for tuning in. It's been a great episode, some great interaction today. Again, next week, we got the Google team, and we're going to be keep doing this every week, every Friday, as long as the crisis endures. I've been lining up people. So if you have something you think people want to know about, if you have a tool, a project, if there's something else that you want to make sure the community at large is aware of, just reach out to me. Twitter is the easiest way. Send me a DM. My DMs are open. And happy to have you on and make sure that people are aware of what you're doing. So until next week, thank you very much. And make sure to look at the blog tomorrow for the winner of this week's Forensics Challenge and look for Sunday for the next one to come out. Thanks, everybody. We will see you next week.